Krystal, what are you taking a look at today?
Well, folks, it was the best of times and it was the worst of times for the American left. On the one hand, Cori Bush, as we mentioned earlier, forced a rare victory against the Biden administration, proving what could be possible with just a few committed voices of moral clarity calling out the failures of establishment Democrats directly. On the other hand, an organized coalition of money and power was able to defeat one of the best among us. Nina Turner went down to defeat in an Ohio special election. Worse yet, Nina lost to a candidate mired in a corruption scandal and buoyed by money and support from some of the worst people on the entire planet. So as far as the campaign autopsy goes, what happened to Nina? It's really not all that complicated, guys. Millions of dollars in outside money were dropped on her head in the final weeks of this campaign. Jordan Sheridan, he was there on the ground. He said it wasn't just the negative ads, but the billboards that were everywhere in the district reminding voters of Nina's rather brutally honest assessment that voting for Joe Biden was like eating half a bowl of shit. In typical truth-telling fashion, Nina herself laid out what she thought happened in the campaign in her concession speech.
See, we didn't lose this race. Evil money manipulated and maligned in this election.
So plenty of the ads those millions bought were packed full of lies. They actually sent out mailers declaring that Nina Turner didn't support $15 minimum wage and didn't support universal health care. Can you imagine a more brazen fabrication? Now, the fact that those mailers went out tells you that, much like Bernie before her, Nina did not lose because she was backing unpopular issues and causes. That'll be how plenty of the corporate types will spin it, but that is not remotely what happened here. Again, we know that because they tried to confuse the voters into thinking that Nina's opponent, Chantel Brown, was really the candidate who would stand for the progressive values that Nina Turner actually does stand for. There's also going to be plenty of second-guessing about Nina's strategy and the campaign that she ran. Of course, you can always second-guess tactical decisions, but she definitely ran a strong campaign, a campaign to be proud of. She got a lot of local validators and endorsers. She had plenty of grassroots funds and volunteers. She put together some terrific ads that we covered, and Nina herself is one of the most charismatic and talented politicians that we've got. But we also have to say that a core of the anti-Nina message did land with the electorate, at least sufficiently, that this race went from Nina having a more than 30-point advantage to defeat in just a matter of weeks. So what was that message? Why did it land? Their case against Nina was that she would rock the boat too much, would be too willing to call out Democrats, would speak in unvarnished language about their flaws and failings, hence the ubiquitous bowl of shit ads. Chantel Brown, on the other hand, she would never speak out. She would go along to get along. She would never challenge Joe Biden or any other Democratic luminary. That message was apparently very compelling, at least in this majority Black and working class district that is ranked the 12th poorest of all the congressional districts in the country. Now, that might be a depressing fact, but it is a fact we've got to face nonetheless. And before we get all self-righteous about, oh, these silly voters, they don't understand their own best interests, or before we imagine and pretend that a more radical Nina would have magically held appeal in a district where Bernie Sanders lost overwhelmingly to Biden, we need to think about why it might be rational for voters in this district to respond to the don't rock the boat case that Jim Clyburn and others were making. The truth is, if you are Black and you are working class, you might not have the luxury of high expectations from your government. Talk of transformational change, it might seem downright naive and foolish. It could be an entirely rational choice, given that Joe Biden is president and Pelosi is speaker, that your best bet is just to get a representative who doesn't provoke the ire of the vindictive powers that be, who's going to do what they can to climb the ladder in the prescribed manner, not cause trouble, and be in a position to get a few good things for the district through the nature of their cozy relationships with people in power. Maybe you feel like that's really the best you can hope for here, especially given that the squad hasn't exactly always delivered on their promises. More on that in just a moment. A politics of getting the bits you can incrementally grab doesn't sound so crazy or foolish at all. So when Jim Clyburn comes to town and says, hey, I'm with Chantel Brown, and by the way, this Nina Turner person, she just pisses everybody off. Well, that's pretty compelling. So what can be done about that? Well, Cori Bush just gave us a little bit of an answer here and a surprisingly hopeful development. As you all probably know and we discussed earlier, Congresswoman Bush has personally experienced homelessness, living out of a car with her babies and no other options. She knows that pain viscerally, and that really mattered. because when Biden and Pelosi were collaborating to let the eviction moratorium expire, effectively abandoning millions of Americans to homelessness, Congresswoman Bush, she wasn't having it. She went and she camped down on the Capitol steps and she said, "I am not leaving here until we take care of this." And I want to say I was a little off in my analysis. I allowed my cynicism to take hold and thought this wasn't going to work without pairing it with a more hardball legislative tactic. But Cory and her allies did something that we really haven't seen much in the Biden era. They were direct in saying, this is the fault of Democrats. They created public outrage and made it clear the distance between the hollow rhetoric of Pelosi in the White House and their actual actions. Congresswoman Bush created a moment of undeniable public shaming for the administration, and that was, in fact, a very powerful thing. Within days, Biden went from, sorry, guys, nothing we can do here, to, okay, fine, we'll extend the moratorium for 90% of America. This dude did not even inquire what the CDC might be able to do until Cory and the squad shamed him into it. It's not perfect, of course. Millions are still at risk. This is only a temporary reprieve. But it's also not nothing. Just watch this moment when a family that was about to get evicted got to speak to Congresswoman Bush.
When I put that up, I never thought that anybody would have reached out, especially CNN, and then to hear that a congressperson reached you. This is just amazing. I'm so thankful for that there's people like you out there. I'm so thankful for it. Thank you so much. I'm sorry.
That woman and her babies have a roof over their head at least for a little while longer. And that is effectively the counterargument to Clyburn's go-along-to-get-along politics. It is a tangible example of how having a troublemaker as a representative can materially deliver for you even when they are pissing off power. Voters are going to need a lot more examples of this type of courage creating actual tangible results before they're convinced that this calculus is going to work out for them. But Cori Bush did just provide the model. Now, it is easy to slip into nihilism and think, geez, if even the fabulously talented and delightful Nina Turner, who did everything right, can be defeated, why bother? But that ignores Cori Bush, it ignores India Walton, it ignores $15 minimum wage in Florida and complete drug decriminalization in Oregon. It is a politics, effectively, of abandoning hope for the millions of Americans who deserve better than thinking some tiny incremental access to power is the best that they can possibly hope for. This week showed us all the perils and all the possibilities. Do not cherry pick just the doom. Take it all, learn what there is to learn, and keep moving forward. I think it's easy, especially... Hey guys, thanks so much for watching.
That's right. Just as a reminder, you can become a premium subscriber today. Watch the full show completely uncut. Our reactions to each other's monologues. You get to listen to it. You get to ask us questions. All that good stuff. Link is right there in the description or at breakingpoints.com.
Best of all, great way to say screw you to the mainstream media.